Hey ladies and gentlemen, this is Loomis and B-Balling coming you guys with another episode of the Top 5 series. This episode is going to be the Top 5 Most Consistent Competitive Heroes.
So, 5 consistent heroes? You know, it's an interesting topic, why these heroes have been staying in play for the past... I think we did research until around early 2010, if I'm not mistaken.
Right, so the time frame for this topic, it's going to be from the beginning of 2010, which I'm sure some of you guys have not watched Dota then, to now. So beginning of the Chinese dominance era in the Dota 1 scene, all the way to the end of TI2. So that's going to be our time frame. And I think one of the most consistent factor for this top five is all five of these heroes are extremely versatile. And we're going to bring up that topic time and time and time after again. But before we get into the actual list, we do have a honorable mention. For my honorable mention, it's Invoker. Ever since he got the stats buff, which is at the end of 2010, I believe, he's basically been around top pick, I have to say, throughout time. He wasn't around when Dota 2 first came out because, you know, Invoker was in Dota 2 for the beginning half. But once Invoker got ported back in, he was constantly pick again. So because he wasn't there at the beginning of 2010 and because he kind of missed some action when Dota 2 came out, I couldn't put him in the list, but he's very, very close to the list.
Right, and keep in mind that this happened at the end of 2010. Before then, he saw, you know, very, very niche role. He was picked, like, once in a blue moon. But now, you know, ever since he nerfed Quas Wex, ever since that happened, he's been versatile, and that's a trademark of this series, how versatile these heroes are, and that's why they managed to stay relevant. Quas Wex into Exort, back into Quas Wex when the Chinese made it really popular with Ferrari counter-ganking, and then back into Exort, and then back into Quas Wex again.
But that's just the honorable mention. The other one is Morphling. He kind of evolved over time. Back in the days, he was a de facto carry, and he definitely is a still very, very powerful carry. But nowadays, with the addition of the Ethereal Blade, the shotgun ability, and the fact that, you know, people discover him as a great solo mid, yeah, you've seen basically every single lane, offensive trial lane, of course defensive dual lanes, solo mid. He does a lot. He's a versatile carry, and he's been evolving over time as well. So, and he's basically been picked since the beginning of time, I believe.
Yeah, I think Icefrog has had a lot of trouble balancing Morphling. First, he, in order to make him competitive, he gave him the buff that when you love Morph, you get stats. And then he took that away from him a bit. And then, of course, people realized how good Replicate was, because back in the old days, nobody realized how good Replicate was, and you could, you know, replicate your Manta illusions, push the tower pretty much by yourself effortlessly once you pick up Manta style. And of course, that happened around the time Manta style was reworked, so Manta style was a ridiculously good item for ranged heroes, and it still is. But then he buffed him again and nerfed his armor just to help him balance him out a bit. But the problem with Morphling is that he just survives everything, and the trademark of a carry these days is that if you don't do ridiculous damage right off the bat, you had to have an escape mechanism. Morphling survives with the best of them.
Yeah, and there's a rumor from the Valve office that Morphling might get another kind of change nerf or something because of this recent performance.
One more thing to talk about Morphling. He wasn't seen in Dota 2 at the beginning because of the popularity of Anti-Mage, but then he's seen a lot more because Morph got buffed.
All right, that's going to be enough for our honorable mention. Let's actually get into the top five list itself.
Number five, we had Tide. Shen and Crystalmane and Luminous made very persuasive arguments about Crystalmane. I thought in the beginning, since we always know Shen for Melk, and Melk's been around forever, Shen for Puppy, and Puppy's been around forever, I thought Shen would be a lot more played than he was. He actually had him at number 3 when we started this list, but actually Shen, he's always been popular in Dota 2, he's always been one of the bans. But in Dota 1, he sort of faded out just because the Chinese don't really like jungling, and it's more been a European pick for Shen.
Yeah, I mean, back in the Chinese 2010 era, if those of you guys that watched that period of time and remember back then, it was all about trial lanes. It was trial lane versus trial lane, and doing a jungle was most likely a suicide because their trial lane, you know, having things like Visage, Crystal Maiden, or Nuke and Carry Sven, things of that nature, that just will kill your trial lane. You gotta just fight trial lane against trial lane, and jungler was not there at all in the Chinese scene. And Chinese was dominating throughout the entirety of 2010, so I mean, he is a very, very, you know, time-tested hero, but at the beginning of 2010, he wasn't the most popular hero, so we couldn't include him too high on the list. Now, with that said, he was very, very popular in the European scene, like B-Balling mentioned, talking about Melk, talking about Puppy, and also one of the things that to mention is there weren't many good Chen players back then. Like, players get better over time. Nowadays, you have a good Chen player in every single team. Back then, Chen is, again, one of those very niche heroes. You'll just ban a hero against that one team, like MYM, Melk Chen. You won't actually learn to play a Chen. So, and of course, it has changed, you know, very much so. So, you know, not too high on the list. But quickly jumping to Crystal Maiden as our other kind of number five. She's not seen too much anymore. We've seen her like once or twice in the TI2. But back in, you know, back in the beginning of 2010, 2011, and a little bit of beginning of 2012, she's constantly picked simply because she does a lot. And her build evolved throughout time, right? Back in, you know, 2010, she was a trialing specialist, would have max aura by 7 to help the carries. And then it got less and less aura. It became the max Nova build. And then it became the no aura build. So the build of Crystal Maiden changed throughout time. The way people played her changed. And she's versatile. Again, fits in most situations.
Yeah, the thing about Crystal Maiden is that she has died out a little bit as Dota's come on. Chen, on the other hand, has been, you know, consistently, even every single game in the Chinese and the European scenes, we see Chen. Even in Chinese versus Chinese, like, Long DD having one of the best Chens in the business is always banned against DK and other Chinese teams. Thing about Crystal Maiden is that she was a lot more popular in both scenes in 2010 and 2011. She was constantly banned, if not picked, within the first three picks. And right. There was a couple reasons. One was that Aura, at first, maxed up to 3.0 mana regen per second. And that's why Luna said, you know, you max the Aura. And then it got nerfed to 2.0. But then people realized, her other skills, they're pretty good. They're pretty good. And anyway, and then I remember the first time watching that Auraless build. I think it was played by Arzart in a TPL match. I mean, he might have done it earlier, but that just literally blew my mind. I was like, wow. No Aura? Who needs Aura?
Yeah, just went for stats afterwards. Just skipped the ultimate as well. But our next hero is quite different in terms of skill build and his role and what his item builds is. This hero changes throughout time very much so, and I might have to say he's very mysterious in nature as well.
At number four, this hero is the Enigma, and he truly is. He has so many different ways to play him. And when I was doing some research on this, because, you know, I was scouring through the Ghosted Gamers replay banks, and it was a bit surprising, because at first I was a bit skeptical, because the Euros didn't really like Enigma, and I paid a bit more attention to the European scene in Dota 1, rather than the Chinese scene. But even the European games, he was constantly banned, if not seen the second round of picks, and of course, we all know DGC. Or at least Luminous knows DGC, his favorite player.
Yeah, DGC been around forever. And again, this goes all the way back to the beginnings of 2010. Back in the days, Enigma was played as a long lane. I've seen the DGC famous 10 clarity build. You just stand there and keep denying with Eidolons and try to last it. Those were the days you also basically max Eidolon, or at least prioritize my Eidolons, because you just sat in the lane forever. And you basically use the extra damage and extra HP of Eidolon and try to control the lane. Now, throughout time, he's moving into the jungle, sometimes coming out of the safe lane to get a push on. His item build also changed. Back in the days of 2010, it was nothing but a Blink Dagger rush, Blink Dagger into your BKB. He was your kind of your third row, your semi-carry of nature. He got a lot of farm. Nowadays, you know, it could be a Blink sometimes. We've seen a lot of mech first. We've seen a lot of Soul Ring first. With the addition of Soul Ring, he got a different build. Sometimes we see even more of a defensive Enigma with like a Pipe Rush. We don't see too often. Puppy had Vanguard Enigma. So this hero is very, very versatile in terms of what he brings to the team. He was just a black hole specialist back in the day, but nowadays, great pusher, sometimes kind of gets utility for your team depending on the item he builds. So evolution throughout time for Enigma.
Yeah, it's definitely interesting that you mentioned that, just because we've seen him banned, picked so often, both Dota 1 and Dota 2. There was a phase in Dota 2 where I don't think he was banned nearly as much, but now since team fights have been becoming more popular since pushing all that, he's definitely seen a resurgence. But one thing I do have to note, and this will be a recurring theme as we go forward with the next three, is your mention of Soul Ring, and Soul Ring has definitely changed the game. I think before Soul Ring was introduced, we might not have seen the next three heroes around.
Or at least not in high numbers, but yeah, Soul Ring definitely changing a lot of builds, because, you know, we'll talk about Soul Ring as we get onto it, but this is going to come down to the next hero, which is...
The next hero on the list is your favorite Master of Beasts, the Beastmaster, Rexxar.
Yeah, well, not known as Rexxar anymore, but yeah, Beastmaster, back in the days, we've seen him solo mid, and he's like once in a blue moon nowadays does go back in a solo mid, and he's pretty good at solo mid, right? You know, the access for lane control, and you know, it was always the Axis into the Call of the Wild. You use the Hawk to check the runes, you use the Axis to push your lane, and then you go into the river to grab the runes. Throughout 2010, 2011, we saw the build changing a little bit. Eventually, it got into a little bit more aura-based Inner Beast. People were stacking it with Vengeful Spirit Aura, Shadow Fiend Aura, whatever aura you could think of that stacks. And of course, the Inner Beast build also pretty good in mid lane, considering that it gives your creeps more attack speed, so it pushes lane, you grab the runes again. And then in Dota 2, you got into the evolution of the suicidal lane Beastmaster, where you stack the Ancients, use the Soul Ring that B-Balling mentioned, and go for a lot of pulls. But he's constantly been around because he's versatile. He gives you aura, he gives you some decent counter push, he gives you very good late game insurance, even against very, very powerful carries. Great way to cancel some of the biggest black holes in the game. BKBs are not immune. So he does a lot for your team, and because of that, he's constantly in almost every single game.
Yeah, and just to go a little bit more behind the reasoning of this list, this might be a bit boring, and I apologize, but, you know, when you're thinking about it, ranking the heroes, like, all these heroes we see a lot, but more it was about the consistency, rather than first pick, first ban status, it is, are they picked and banned in these games? And Beastmaster had more picks and bans than Enigma, just because he's quite, frankly, a bit more versatile than Enigma. He has anti-push, he has the roar for initiation, and unlike Enigma, his roar can be casted quite often, so he's a bit more suitable in ganking laps, he's good in teamfight with the aura and the axes, he's a bit more pushy as well, so he can fit so many different roles, and the introduction of Soul Ring definitely gave him a new way to play. It's been interesting to see, even though the skill build has sort of reverted back to the axes Call of the Wild build, his item build has sort of made different because he went for the Soul Ring first now rather than rushing the bottle.
Oh yeah, the item build back in the days, I mean, it was the solo mid, it was Boots, Bottle, and Gem from a lot of Chinese players. We saw a lot of Necro 3 rushes, we saw Blink Daggers. Nowadays, it's about getting the healing for your team. We see Mech quite frequently, we sometimes see Pipe. So again, kind of jack of all trades when it comes down to item build. Very much so utility based. Also back in TI2, we saw a lot of Agamemnon Scepters. So he's all over the place with his item builds, and of course skill build, and you talked about the versatility. He just kind of does it all, and he's only at number 3, though.
We have an even more annoying, threatening hero at number 2. It is the Broodmother.
Yeah, Broodmother, I kind of could not believe Broodmother was you know, so high up on this list. Yeah, simply because in my memory, I couldn't actually remember seeing her at all at the beginning of 2010, during the Chinese dominance era. And the reason that we didn't see her that often was because she's constantly first banned. Like, every single game you go back to, 2010, first ban. And we don't see her too often in terms of dominating the game, but the players are just so afraid of it. And sometimes you see Broodmother on the long lane nowadays, and we're fully aware what she's capable of doing. And her build mostly, her skill build definitely stayed basically the same throughout time. She got a buff where her Spiderling is able to do more damage to heroes, so she become a better hero killing and thus a better pusher overall because she could drive heroes out of the lane. Again, going back to B-Balling's point about Soul Ring, that added so much more early game offense to that hero. And, it used to be the, you know, Basalius into a Vlad's build, into that Black King bar. Now it's just Soul Ring straight into Orchid or BKB. And the buff of Orchid also helped this hero out. So the item buffs alongside her and the fact that she's just such a powerful lane contribution hero that she's been around and standing the test of time.
Yeah, it's a bit interesting is that she's one of these heroes who's had a decent number of reworks in comparison to the other ones. Back in the day, you couldn't have the spiders be invisible, but now you can. And
which is a huge kind of stealth buff.
Yeah, and back in the day, the towers took 100% damage from spiders, right?
Yep.
And now they do like 50.
Well, I'm not sure if it's 100%, but the spiders lane got changed to better do more damage to heroes instead of buildings.
Correct. So Broodmother, she's had reworks, but the overall power of her split push and her skill set and the fact that she can become such a monster with her ultimate and she can contribute significant DPS if she ever leaves her lane. And the fact that she has ridiculous move speed, which also got buffed even though they've tried to rework her, she just stays on top.
Every game she's going to be played as the same. The way that you force the team to react against it. You know it's coming, but can you deal with it? That's kind of always the golden question where you're playing against a Broodmother. But enough about Broodmother. Let's talk about the most time-tested hero of all time.
Must we? I think this will just turn into a bitter rant if I have to talk about this hero.
At least for you. For you, it's going to be a bitter rant. For me, I'm going to appreciate the evolution of the hero.
It is the number one hero, the hero I rant against. It is the Windrunner.
All right, so I'll give you the mic first. What's wrong with Windrunner? Why do you think she's boring?
She's designed well. The only reason why I think she's boring is because we've literally seen her in 90% of the games in the past 3 years. Like, that's the only reason why I think she's boring. She's skill intensive, she requires skill, but she's been seen in every single game. My God, if there was ever a definition for consistency, this is it. She has been in every game.
She's been around with Dota 2 for a long time, and when we talked about first on the list, B-Ball just slammed down the first hero, Windrunner, and I just had to agree. She's been around for a long time, and I think one thing that also contributes to the fact that she's quote-unquote a very boring hero to watch is she just does the same thing every single game.
Right.
Like 95% of the time she goes on a long lane, it's phase boots. Sometimes you see Trits once in a blue moon. Sometimes you see Arcane Boots. And then it was things like Mech. And then it was things like Force Staff. And then it was, you know, Hex. And then, you know, whatever else she goes on. Sometimes players like King J like to go for Orchid Rush. Sometimes player would go for a support. And, you know, you buy, you know, Soul Rings, go basic boots, Magic Wand, and then go for wards. But those are the rare games. And mostly every single game she played, it's the exact same thing. Throughout the year, there was very little evolution. She's just consistent. And I gotta agree, sometimes she is kind of boring to watch.
And just to sort of go back to the item builds, the items have changed. They changed in the beginning, but now it's pretty much the same for the past year. In the beginning, you know, people had pretty ridiculous
when they
ideas.
Didn't know how to play the hero that well
right.
yet.
But people, even when they first, ever since Windrunner got a Shackle reworked where it's more consistent on the landing, that's when she sort of rose into power, becoming more consistent, because everybody realized Shackle is pretty ridiculous, and even now, Shackle is still ridiculous. But in the beginning days, people often did Orchid, sometimes did Lothars to help land that Shackle shot. Once in a blue moon for the lulls, they do Battle Fury and Maelstrom. But now, ever since like the past 2 years, year and a half, it's the same stuff over and over again. It's, like Luna said, Phase Boots, Force Staff, Mecha. It's just, it's the same thing, and I mean, like, why try to fix what ain't broke?
Right, I mean, if we talked about Beastmaster and his versatility, the Broodmother, and the fact that she's very difficult to deal with, Windrunner gives you almost anything, like, everything that you need from a hero, she gives to you. She's a powerful, good laning because of her animation. As an intelligence hero, she gives you some late game extension, give you great accessibility into utility-based items like Force Staff and Mech. The late-game item I was talking about earlier was Scythe of Ice. As a laner, she's great. I talked about the attack animation. Power Shot is an okay counter-pushing spell, depending on what's pushing against her. So she just does so much. In terms of team fight, she gives you Shackle Shot. Of course, Snipes from Power Shot, we've seen it a billion times. Whatever your team needs, like, oh, we need a pusher. Well, she does that too. We need a team fight hero. She does that too. So she just fits into any single team, and no surprise that she's constantly picked.
Yeah, and just something that I find funny these days. I mean, it's all true. These players who use her are immensely skilled. They're 800,000 times better than I ever will be. But something that I find funny is that Shackle Shot, when it first was, when they landed, we'd call it, oh, why do I have Shackle Shot?
Yeah.
And then it would be, oh, Tron Shackle Shot. And now it's, oh, Light of Heaven, Dendi Shackle Shot. It's like, okay. I think we realize it might not be the players, it might be the skill. And of course, these players are a trillion times better than I'll ever be. And, you know, it takes skill to land it. But it might just be coming down to the skill itself as well.
Yeah, I mean, the wow factor you get from Shackle Shot is just truly how broken is 3.75 seconds of stun on two heroes. I mean, not many stuns in the game get better than that. So that's why she stands the test of time. And I do not imagine that she is going to be moving anywhere from this list anytime soon, because the hero's so well designed. B-Balling mentioned that earlier. I don't think she's going to see any change. And because of that, she's always gonna be a good laner. Her stun is always gonna be that powerful. She's gonna always have access into Mech and Force Staff and Hex. She's gonna be here forever. And that's going to be our top five most consistent competitive heroes. Of course, join me, what's B-balling from DotaCommentators.com. I'll put his YouTube link in the description below. You could check him out. And of course, I'm Luminous. And thank you guys for watching. Until next time, this is Luminous B-balling. And we are signing off. Cheers, you guys.